God bless you. Now, we move to Romans chapter 1, verse 25, and our message, worshiping the creature. How far can the church get away from what God has called her to be? We're going to see in this lesson. Now, the last 11 verses of the first chapter of the book of Romans is perhaps the most graphic language of the Bible. From a believer to a reprobate in 11 short verses. Now think of that. Now we're going to go to Romans 1 and verse 25. Who changed the truth of God into a lie and worshiped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. Now, we live in a world in which all things are passing away. Kingdoms, empires, cities, ancient institutions, families, all are liable to change and corruption. One universal law seems to prevail everywhere. In all created things, there is a tendency to decay, and it always comes from the inside out. But there's one created thing which is an exception to the universal rule, and that is the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, there's many versions of it, but the true church ever remains the same. Movements come to naught, but out of the ashes of their decay, there always rises a remnant. Although the good effect of a revival runs on long, after the first wave of emotions, its first wake are spent. There comes a time when this must end too, and the movement then falls into decay. The life goes out. It becomes an influence, not for good, but for evil. Instead of liberating, that movement that brought revival becomes an agent of oppression. The mighty movement birthed in the second chapter of the book of Acts was no exception to this law of decay. In 30 short years, signs of corruption and idolatry began to appear. Few things in life are more sad than the swiftness with which the good gets tarnished or corrupted. Look back with me for a moment at the great revival movements of the past. You consider with me the revival under Luther that broke the back of Romanism and ushered in the Renaissance, delivering mankind from serfdom. Now, the movement that birthed that earth-shaking revival now endorses the papacy and categorically denies the inerrancy of the Bible, the virgin birth, and the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, Lutheranism as a whole has become an instrument of deception, posing as a Christian institution, yet much of it denying the very message of Christ. Further, consider the Wesleyan revival, which, according to secular historians, saved Europe from the fate of the French Revolution and swept millions and millions into the kingdom of God. Now today, that holy vessel that God used to pour himself through to a darkened world has become a part of the darkness. The great Pentecostal church, which has been so profoundly used of God, is following the same path of corruption and idolatry, and is fast becoming an influence for evil and not for good. Now, the great question that must be asked and answered is, how can a movement born in such purity, beauty, and power become so quickly corrupted? Now, the cause of all idolatry is the natural corruption of the human heart. That family disease, which all the children of Adam are infected from their birth, shows itself in this, as it does in a thousand other ways. Out of the same fountain which precede evil thoughts, adulteries, fornication, murder, theft, covetousness, wickedness, and the like, Mark 7:21-22, out of that same fountain arises false views of God and false views of the worship that is due to that holy God. And therefore, when the apostle tells the Galatian church in Galatians 5:19-20 what the works of the flesh are, he places prominently among them idolatry. Now, idolatry is a worship in which the honor due to God and to him alone is given to some of his creatures or to some invention of his creatures. Idolatry is the willful allowing of the natural man to touch that which is holy. It is a turning from the Holy Spirit to the vain philosophies and psychology of the flesh. Now, who can deny but what we are there today? Everywhere, counseling has taken the place of gospel preaching. All of a sudden, it's the music that's more important than the preaching. On that day of Pentecost, when the church was born, the physical sign was a cloven tongue of fire. That is, fire-baptized preaching was the way she cut her way through the councils, the mobs, the Jewish thought against them, all of this. It was by this preaching. But today, all of that has almost become history. I was in a church. They said, our pastor usually preaches about 10 minutes. Well, the song service lasted 1.5 hours. As they sing little courses, mostly about themselves. When I took that pulpit, I said, I demand equal time. The message of the gospel has been pushed to a back burner in the church, and the results are predictable. It is to make the same choice of the first Adam, where we become our own God. Idolatry is the preacher making his presumption the gospel. He presumes a thing about God and then preaches that as if it was so. That is the essence of idolatry. It is to love ourselves more than we love God, and this is the most evident characteristic of the third generational Pentecostal church. The truth has been modified to prevent the offending of that which God hates, the flesh. The cross is an offense. Paul asked the question, has the cross lost its offense? When this gospel is preached in its purity and uncompromising, it will offend that flesh. That flesh will either come, be broken and come to God, or turn away in hatred for the same God. You know, we're told now not to mention the name of Jesus in our advertising. Do not call the unchurched sinners, call them pre-Christians. Avoid the term of born again. We're told that it's no longer either or, but both, and the list is endless of what's come to be called the gospel and the warning against offending people. Thus, the carnal, depraved human is given more reverence than God Almighty. How can that ever happen? How in the name of heaven did we ever get where we are? That's the reason God put it upon my heart to bring this series of message to the elect of God. He said if it were possible, even the elect would be deceived. I felt strongly to bring these message, a pathway to an overcoming life, because they are the only ones that are going to be a part of that bridal company and rule with Christ forever. But the path to this deplorable state is clearly outlined in the first chapter of the book of Romans. In verse 18 of that first chapter of Romans, Paul speaks of those who hold the truth in unrighteousness. Now, to hold the truth in unrighteousness means, by implication, the wrong character is portrayed. God is not seen. We come to worship that creature more than the Creator. So instead of man being used to portray God, God is used to portray man, because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God has shown it unto them. Verse 19. Everything that is to be known of God and can be known in time is in the believer, filled with the Holy Ghost. Man was created for one purpose, and that was to manifest God. It's clear from all through the Bible that the purpose of the creation was to manifest God's Son to a universe. The Bible said, as Christ is in this world, so are we. Now think on this. As Christ is, so are we. Now, when you read that in 1 John 4:17 and understand that the sole purpose of Christ on this planet was to be a revealer of God. Paul said that in the book of Colossians. He said, Christ was the invisible image of the invisible God. Now the purpose of the church then, as a body of Christ, as he is, so are we, is to be a revealer of the Christ. That's why we're here. But today we become a revealer of celebrities of religion that change their mind every time somebody challenges what they preach. We have some of the biggest names in religion. Amen today. John Hagee said that Christ wasn't the Messiah of the Jew, then went on to say that Christ never even claimed to be the Messiah. See, all of this has taken the place. See, when the preacher, the music, or the program become the predominant attraction, the plague of idolatry has got a foothold in the church. This was the situation in Romans 1, and this is the situation in the 20th century Pentecostal church right now. When they knew God, they glorified him not as God. Verse number 20, not liking what they saw, they changed the glory of the incorruptible God into an image made like the corruptible man. God was used instead of worship. If you'll listen to that prosperity message today, you'll see that's exactly what it is. God, if they're attempting to use this great God instead of worshiping him. God has become the servant of man, and instead of man being the servant of God. But listen to this. Wherefore God gave them up to uncleanness through the lust of their own heart. God simply gave them what they wanted. Man became the object of their worship. He turned them over to the flesh and to the worship of that flesh. Now, when the flesh becomes a source of life and inspiration to the church, the creature has now become the object of worship. I can tell you, they go to these big name preachers like they go to hear rock stars. They go there not looking for God. You can have have one of those big name preachers into a town. I know this is not true of all. There are great ones out there. But many of them, you can't get the people into the building. But you tell that crowd, you tell them, say, now look, in the morning here, there's going to be a prayer meeting in the same building, and there's nobody going to be here but Christ to meet us. You'll be the loneliest man in that city. The buster generation, as it's called, would never voice such a thing, but action speaks louder than words. By psychologically evaluating man to find his strength and weaknesses, says in no uncertain terms, their trust is in the flesh and not in the Spirit of God. Let we warn you now that if you're a Christian believer and you found a psychologist who can explain to you exactly what happened to you in the matter of your faith, you have been unfrocked. At the very moment that man's experience in Christ can be broken down and explained by the psychologist, we have just another church member on our hands and not a believing Christian. Their source is now the genius of man and not Christ. The creature is worshiped more than the Creator. The quest in this fleshly control system is for personalities. But God never asks for personalities, though they are the first condition with all worldly enterprises. God calls persons and makes them personalities. The gift of the Spirit of God is a gift, a personality that possesses man's spirit and empowers him for all of the will of God. God takes the simple and confounds the wise. Paul said, when I am weak, then I am strong. 2 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 10. Hudson Taylor, founder of the China Inland Missions, was asked once why he thought God called him to evangelize inland China. And his response was, he had a difficult time finding someone weak enough to do the job. The answer was and is that always, not I, but Christ. God's only need in this crisis hour is the presenting ourselves at His altar as simply an empty possibility, open to be filled and used of Him. Now, once the image was set and man became the dominant figure, a theology had to be created to support it. Absolute truth had to be compromised. Who changed the truth of God into a lie and worshiped and served the creature more than the Creator. Now, the message must justify the image. So the pulpit was filled with the psychologist, whose message is not the flesh crucified and Christ glorified, but rather now it's a better self-image. That nature which Christ nailed to Calvary was resurrected by the so-called Church of God. The message is no longer put off the old man and put on the new. It is crucify the new that the old may live. For this cause, God gave them up to vile affections. For even their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature. And likewise, the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust one toward another. That's Romans 1, 26 and 27. Now, the word of God was perverted to justify the image that was projected. See, God's word will not tolerate all of this vain thing that's being projected in the name of Christianity today. This sensuality and all of these things, this liquor drinking, theater going, half-naked crowd could not, the gospel would not tolerate tolerate that. So a new message had to be preached. Since everything is held together by the word of his power, once the word of God was perverted, God gave them, the people, over to a perverted spirit. Rampant homosexuality has marked the end of every civilization. This is the result of worshiping the creature more than the Creator. Now, this pathway of idolatry, making the carnal mind the source of spiritual work, is always downward. From the unclean to the perverted to the reprobate mind, having perverted the Word of God to create a theology that would justify their lifestyle, the Buster generation reached the point where they did not want to retain God in their knowledge. This does not mean they'll divorce themselves from God, but rather they'll use God to sell their new theology and carnal schemes. But they did not want him, who is the truth, to interfere in their thinking and acting. The Neo-Pentecostal expresses his desire not to retain God in his knowledge by breaking connection with the past. So where are we? We have a theology being taught and seems to be catching on that this third generation of Pentecost cannot relate to God in the same manner that the first generation Pentecost related to him. This is a total contradiction of the Word of God. God's answer to all spiritual problems, Jeremiah 6:16, thus saith the Lord God, stand in the ways and seek, ask for the old path, where's a good way, and walk therein, and you will find rest for your soul. Turn back to Pentecost, to Calvary, and this is the answer to everything.